That's better. You never know about Jane. Welcome, everyone, to this hour of worship. We come to worship the living God. This is a call to worship that appears in the Living Lift Up Your Hearts hymnal. We gather in your presence, King of the universe, to acclaim your great salvation. You have done marvelous things. You rescued your people from sin and death through the mighty work of Jesus, your Son. You send missionaries to the ends of the earth. You raise up prophets to witness to justice. You reveal your righteousness to the nations. Send forth your Spirit, Lord. Renew the face of the earth. Let's unite in silent prayer. Lord, we thank you for the privilege of coming into your presence so openly, so boldly. We thank you for the day of rest set apart from all the other days of the week. We thank you for your care and provision over all that you have made. We pray that you would bless our time in your presence, renew our spirits, and lead us in paths of righteousness. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. We're going to be using as a song of praise, "We Worship You Whose Splendor Dwarfs the Cosmos." And nope, it's not a familiar song, but the tune is not difficult, right, Jane? Very familiar, she said. So the way this works is you sing stanza one and two as a couplet, and then do the refrain and three and four as a couplet. And do the refrain. Let's stand to sing. I guess. Pardon? Do you have three and four? The next? Oh, you don't? Okay. Then we'll move on to the greeting. Congregation of the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father, the Lord Jesus, through the Holy Spirit. Amen. The contemporary testimony is that up? Fifth, yeah, there we go. This is from Our World Belongs to God, otherwise known as the Contemporary Testimony. It's the very last paragraph. So it's got to do with the consummation of everything. God bringing all things together to its proper close. Let's say this or read this together. With the whole creation, we wait for the purifying fire of judgment. For then we will see the Lord face to face. He will heal our hurts, end our wars, and make the crooked straight. Then we will join in the new song to the Lamb without blemish, who made us a kingdom and priests. God will be all in all. Righteousness and peace will flourish. Everything will be made new. And every eye will see at last that our world belongs to God. Hallelujah. Come, Lord Jesus. Our next hymn is Day of Judgment, Day of Wonders, and we are using the familiar tune, not the one that will appear with the words. You may be seated. Yeah. Let's turn to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we come to you in this evening hour, we're so grateful that you have called us in Jesus' name to know you, to live for you, to worship you. And we pray, Father, that your Spirit would be among us, leading and directing our thoughts, and we may be drawn nearer to you. We thank you for the opportunities to lift your name in praise and to bring you the glory that you deserve. We know that there are many in our world who refuse to do exactly that. We pray for them. We pray that their eyes and their hearts may yet be opened. We pray that they may yet discover that you are there. You are real. You are present. And you are eager to be their Lord. So we ask God for those who proclaim the gospel in many different places and ways. We read of Freedom's Gate. We read of Justice for All. We read of a big anniversary for a Christian school right here in our town. All of these institutions are places where your name is glorified, are places where you are acknowledged. And we pray, God, that you would continue to bless and guide those who give leadership to each of these institutions. We pray you would bless and guide our council as it meets tomorrow night. As work goes forward with the search committee, We pray that you would bless and guide them. We pray that in all of this time we may trust you, that you know exactly where you're leading us and what the outcome will be. So we pray, Father, that our trust may grow in you. We thank you, Father, for the opportunity of gathering on retreat. We thank you for those who planned and led. And we thank you for all that took place. We pray that blessing and relationships may grow through it too, with you and with one another. We ask, Father, that you would open your word to us. May we hear it clearly. May I proclaim it clearly. And we pray, Father, that your Spirit would open our hearts and minds. In Christ's name, amen. A couple of weeks ago, I had the privilege of going along with one of my sons, Christopher, my second son, going along with him and his two teenagers on a trip to Glacier National Park and to Banff, Canada. Well, I had been to Yellowstone, and I guess I had been to the Grand Tetons, but I had never been to those northern Rockies. And it was quite a remarkable sight. For those of you who've been there, you know what I'm talking about. The mountains seem very grand. There's waterfalls everywhere, and nice, clear, cold streams running together and merging into rivers. And there were the ice caps, which we saw more of as we went to Banff and on to the ice fields. So it was fascinating to me to stand, maybe a third of the way in front of a 1,600 foot tall mountain. It was fascinating to be there and to experience how humbled and small we really are. All of that led me to Psalm 104, and I think you'll understand as we go along why I say that. Psalm 104 has, I believe, three movements. The first is a historical look backward at the beginning. And the second movement is very present. It's a look at the present. And the final movement is a look at the culmination, the finality of God's plan for this earth. The overarching theme of the psalm is to acknowledge God and to give God, who is clothed with splendor and majesty, the kind of adoration, the kind of worship that he deserves. So it starts out, "Praise the Lord, O my soul. O Lord my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty." That's the introduction. Now, it's not hard for us who know the New Testament to have those words from Romans 1 come to mind. In Romans 1, Paul says that God displays himself, his wonder, his majesty, his might, his reality. God puts that all on display in the things that he has made. But people perversely refuse to see it and refuse to acknowledge the true God. Well, this next section is what I would call the past, or maybe it's better to call it the beginning. He goes on to say, God wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out the heavens like a tent and lays the beams of his upper chambers on their waters. He makes the clouds his chariot and rides on the wings of the wind. He makes winds his messengers, flames of fire his servants. He set the earth on its foundations. It can never be moved. You covered it with the deep as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. But at your rebuke, the waters fled. At the sound of your thunder, they took to flight. They flowed over the mountains. They went down into the valleys, to the place you assigned for them. You set a boundary they cannot cross. Never again will they cover the earth. So in the first paragraph here, when we talk about the beginning, we can talk about creation. It's a paragraph that celebrates creation. God calling into existence light and separating that from darkness. God stretching out the heavens above and then setting the beams for the earth beneath. God putting the winds into play to accomplish his purposes in terms of the atmosphere is concerned, in terms of the rain and moisture that's concerned. God putting the processes necessary for life into play here at the beginning of time. He wrapped himself in light as with a garment and got underway creating. But it isn't long and the story shifts. You covered it with the deep as with a garment. Yes, this next stanza is talking about the flood. As great and marvelous and happy as creation was, human beings found ways to perversely dismiss God, reject God, ignore God, so that, as it's described in the story of Noah, their thoughts were wicked continually. And so God judged them, and he judged the earth. He used elements within the earth, the waters under the earth, the waters above the earth. He used all of that to bring together a judgment upon humankind and upon the earth. And so here we read about waters that stand above the mountains. So when you're standing there in front of a high mountain, 16,000 feet or so, it's pretty remarkable to think that the waters were up there. Mount Ararat is around 16,800. And that's apparently where the ark rested. So the waters were up there, above there. And then God rebuked the waters. At the sound of his thunder, they took flight, and they flowed over the mountains, they flowed down the valleys, something you can see anytime you visit a mountainous region. All the waters coursing to where they belong. And interestingly, when you look at the streams, there's all kinds of holes in the rock. You know, all the eddies and the water rushing at different times of the year keeps eroding and taking away rock. You can even find a place where there's huge boulders dotting the field. And evidently, at a certain time of year, those boulders went tumbling along as the water pushed them. But the waters all came down and they flowed over the mountains. They went down into the valleys to the place you assigned for them. And there's this blessing. You set a boundary they cannot cross. Never again will they cover the earth. Now we remember the promise that God gave to Noah. We remember the sign of the promise, the rainbow. But the psalmist here says there's another reason why there'll never be a flood like that. Because God set a boundary that they cannot cross. Now that kind of disputes some of the theories of certain people about how we're all going to be underwater eventually if the earth keeps warming. God set a boundary for the waters, those beneath the earth, those above the earth, and those in the heavens. So this takes us to the beginning, and we see that God is wondrous and majestic, that he's clothed with splendor in his creation. The Old Testament is almost always at war with other ideas about God. One of those ideas is that there is no God, which is still what the Bible is at war with. But the other idea is that there's many gods. Gods all over the place, and they all have their own job to do and all of that. But the creation story wants us to know that there is indeed God, a living being who called into existence other things, and there is but one God, not many. And the other theory that people were apt to follow is that God is in all kind of created things. Maybe God is in that mountain. Maybe he's in that Douglas fir. Maybe God's in the stream. Maybe God is in the sun. You know, all different parts of creation. God is just part of it. No, he isn't part of it. He stands above it. He stands above it, apart, separate. He created it. Well, let's look at this next section. This is the section that I would call the splendor and majesty of God at present. At present. He makes springs, verse 10. He makes springs pour water into the ravines. It flows between the mountains. They give water to all the beasts of the field. The wild donkeys quench their thirst. The birds of the air nest by the waters. They sing among the branches. He waters the mountains from his upper chambers. The earth is satisfied by the fruit of his work. He makes grass grow for the cattle and plants for man to cultivate, bringing forth food from the earth, wine that gladdens the heart of man, oil to make his face shine, and bread that sustains his heart. The trees of the Lord are well watered, the cedars of Lebanon that he planted. There the birds make their nests. The stork has its home in the pine trees. The high mountains belong to the wild goats. The crags are a refuge for the conies. And my footnote says that's for the hyrax. I don't know if we saw conies or hyrax. We did see marmots. Anyway, all of this tells us what's going on right now, right? There's water filling the streams. There's animals finding drink and refreshment in those streams. There's crops being watered. There's some of that watering is happening through irrigation, some of it by natural means and the rains and the like, but there's water flowing all over this planet. Fresh water. Now, maybe you know this, maybe you don't, but without water, a human being can only live about 3 days. We need water that desperately. We can go without food longer, especially if we continue to have water. But if we don't have water or food, maybe 21 days or something like that, 3 weeks. And it's true for the wild animals too. In this passage that we just read, it's all about the wild animals, not domesticated animals. This is about the animals that are out there, the wild donkeys. And the wild goats, the mountain goats, I would guess. The birds. Jesus picked up the birds and talked about them in his parable. He said, you know, you don't do anything to help the birds. Well, some of us try to help them with putting seed out. But ultimately, they are quite independent, and they come and go, migrate, and all the rest, and find their own food. So these are not plants or animals. This isn't the part where human beings are getting involved to take care of the livestock. Humans are mentioned, though, in cultivating food plants. Talks about wheat. We saw a lot of wheat fields. We saw a lot of combining in wheat fields. We saw some corn, of course, before we got too far away, and wine vineyards. I don't know if we saw trees from which oil is drawn. Really don't know. Maybe we did. But I don't believe there's any olive trees in the route we took, which is most likely what is referred to from the psalmist. So we're talking in this section about the present and how God provides for those creatures that he has made. We continue with this provision of God in the present, verse 19. The moon marks off the seasons, and the sun knows when to go down. You bring darkness, it becomes night, and all the beasts of the forest prowl. The lions roar for their prey and seek their food from God. The sun rises and they steal away. They return and lie down in their dens. Then man goes out to his work, to his labor until evening. How many are your works, O Lord? In wisdom you made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. There is the sea, vast and spacious, teeming with creatures beyond number, living things both large and small. There the ships go to and fro, and the Leviathan, which you formed to frolic there. These all look to you to give them their food at the proper time. When you give it to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are satisfied with good things. When you hide your face, they are terrified. When you take away their breath, they die and return to the dust. When you send your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the earth. Here we see that the psalmist talks about the wisdom, that the design, the plan, the thoughtfulness, the consideration that went into God's creation. Even a little thing like light and dark. The sun rises, and the lions and the tigers and all those wild beasts that are roaming around looking for food, they disappear because the sun has come up. They go back to their dens. They probably take with them to their dens what they got for their winter or their overnight hunt and feed their little ones there in the den. And with the sun coming up, human beings get out there, right? Work from sunrise to sunset. So we go to work, people go to work in the daytime. Of course, I know with the industrial age, there are people who work night shifts. But the wisdom of it, that wild animals could live basically at peace with people and people with them and avoid each other a great deal of the time. And there's the sea, with so many things in the sea. So many living things, from tiny, tiny things to Leviathan. Don't know exactly what that is. Maybe it was a great whale. We don't really know. Comes up another time, too, in the Bible. But he points out that all are dependent on God for food, for natural life. All are dependent upon God. And when he opens his hand, in other words, when things go according to God's wisdom and plan, they are also all fed. So the message in this last stanza is that we live in God. We live in God. And all of this, on the one hand, points to the natural order with its regular bounty of food in season. And that's matched to the abilities of various creatures to gather that food in, to gather their own supply of it. But on the other hand, something else is behind it all in this stanza, and this is the outflowing of energy of God. which holds all things in being. The breath, the spirit of every living thing depends on God's spirit. Daniel, when he pronounced judgment on Nebuchadnezzar, this is what he said: "The God in whose hand is your breath, you have not honored." That is the big, awful truth for the secularist, right? The God who holds their breath in his hand, they will not or refuse to honor. Finally, we get to the end of the psalm, verse 31. "May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. He looks at the earth and it trembles. He touches the mountains and they smoke." The psalmist, responds personally to what he's been recalling, what he's been recognizing, what he's been writing. The psalmist responds personally. He says, "I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. May my meditation be pleasing to him as I rejoice in the Lord." I don't need everything to go just as I planned it, to rejoice in the Lord. I don't need to achieve all my dreams to rejoice in the Lord. I just need to recognize all that he has provided for me. And not only me, but his whole creation. And to see how all these things work together to glorify his name and to reveal his wisdom and splendor. And there's a hint of something more. There's a prayer, "May the Lord rejoice in his work." But there's a hint that that isn't always the case. He looks at the earth and it trembles. He touches the mountains and they smoke. There are those who sing to the Lord all their life. There are those who seek to have a pleasing communion and meditation with God. But there are also sinners. And he says, "But may sinners vanish from the earth and the wicked be no more." That's what happened in the days of the flood, right? Only 8 people were there in the ark. And all the others who wanted nothing to do with God and mocked Noah in the process were no more. Just gone, vanished. Apparently, God has something like that in mind for the end of time. In 2 Peter 3, we read this. "First of all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, 'Where is this coming he promised? Ever since our fathers died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation.' But they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens existed and the earth was formed out of water and with water. By water also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly men. Do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth, the home of righteousness. So God doesn't intend to flood the earth again, but he does intend to judge it and to purge it of all wickedness. There is a certain continuation between this present earth and the one that will be. But at the same time, there's a radical discontinuation. In other words, anything that contributes to sinfulness and rebellion against God will be burned off. And only those whose heart is full of songs to the Lord, who praise him throughout their lives, who look to him with thankfulness for all of his provision, only those will continue and be on that new heaven and that new earth, rejoicing in the Lord. May each of us be sure that we rejoice in him and see his hand in nature all around us and in the provision he makes for all of us. Amen. Shall we pray? Father God, we hear from the psalmist and we see this marvelous poem reminding us in so many different statements, so many different ways, poetic ways, picture language, we see him recounting for us your splendor and your majesty, and reminding us that it is never ending. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. We pray, God, that you would move in our hearts, that we may not doubt your care for us under any circumstances, even in our extremities. And so we pray, God, that you would lead us to sing your praises and trust altogether in you. Amen. We return to this song, "We Worship You Whose Splendor Dwarfs the Cosmos." This, of course, I chose it because it is Psalm 104. Each stanza carries the psalm a little further. So let's stand and sing 5 and 6 and the refrain. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you for the work of Love, Inc. We know that there are many in our community that are finding things difficult with inflation and other things going on in our lives and in the workplace. We pray, God, that this ministry will be a blessing to those in our community. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hear this word from Jesus. Behold, I am coming soon. Yes, I am coming soon. We respond, Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with God's people. Amen.